Hi, I'm Lisa Turkhurst with Dr. Joel Mutamale, and this is the second week of Seeing Jesus in the Old Testament. Our focus this week is prophecies, and I really specifically want to look at how do we see Jesus when we're waiting. You know, most of the time when I think of prophecies, I think of the typical ones we hear during Christmas, Isaiah 9, 6 through 7, yeah. Right? And we have this glorious declaration of a Messiah, and it's just beautiful. And I think there's many others that we know that the Messiah, Jesus, was prophesied in the Old Testament, that the Messiah is coming. And I love that. And I love also the study technique that we do when we say, okay, maybe when we're looking at prophecy, maybe it didn't just start with these that we hear at Christmas time in Isaiah. Maybe there is an earlier mention. And I know we love to go and use this principle called the law of first mention. And Joel, often when we do the law of first mention, in other words, where's the first time that we see this prophecy in Scripture, mm-hmm. where do we love to go?
Genesis.
I know. We've been we always seem to turn back to Genesis. So Joel, what was the very first prophecy that we see Jesus in the Bible?
Yeah, this is so intriguing. The very first time that we have the first image, first anticipation, first picture of the coming Messiah, like you can't get past chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. I'm just going to read it for us so that we've got it. This is what it says. And this is God speaking here. He says, I will put enmity between you and the woman. He's talked to the serpent. I'll put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and her offspring. Now, this is really important. This is what he says. So ask this question. Who is the he? He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. Who in the world is this he? And when we look at this from the context of prophecy, and there's a lot of nerdy things that we could do right now and get into the Hebrew and all that, but what we all come to the conclusion of is it is so clear that the he is singular in Hebrew, which means it's pointing to one person. Who is this one person? It's Jesus.
It is.
And so we know that when we go past the pages of Scripture here, that Jesus would, in fact, be bruised. And he would be bruised by the enemy of God, the enemy of God's people, the serpent, and all those that follow after him. Those are the offspring of the serpent, all those that are rebellious and against Jesus and his people. And yet, that momentary wounding would not be an eternal wounding. In fact, the very person who would be bruised, and we know that this was Jesus, that person would step on, would bruise the head of the enemy. And that is exactly
what
took place. Would
actually crush the head of the enemy,
and crush the head of the enemy.
Right.
And this is actually what took place at the cross. Mm. But Lisa, what's really interesting is Genesis 3:15 is often referred to a technical term here. It's called a Proto-Evangelion. Proto means first, and Evangelion is the Greek word for gospel, the good news. And so many would say that this is the first glimmer of the gospel. What's really interesting is this Greek word Evangelion, and we're talking about...
Okay, wait, you've got to like slow down when you say it. I'm just going to speak up on behalf of the average Bible study gal.
Yeah.
Slow down and say it one more time. It is...
The Proto...
Proto-Evangelion.
Gelion. Yeah.
Thank you, Joel.
It's the same word that we get evangelism from.
Okay.
And it's the English word that's translated as gospel. But we're talking about seeing Jesus in the waiting, right? You and I live in a culture of immediacy. Like, I could right now be like, you know what? I'm really hungry. I could go for a pizza. I could always go for a pizza. And I can go to Postmates and just order a pizza, and I will get a pizza from my favorite spot, even if it's like 45 minutes away. Now, here's what's interesting about this Greek word evangelion. It was a word that was used expressively in militaristic terms. And this is the thought. A king has just won a massive battle. He's had the significant battle. It's been won. And now he's got to send messengers because there are multiple battles that are taking place. Like, the king in the ancient world can't just FaceTime all his people and be like, by the way, the war is done. We can stop.
He's got to send out messengers. And it's going to be slow.
And it's going to take time because they got to get on a horse and they've got to go and they've got to evangelion. They've got to declare the good news of this quote unquote gospel, the good news that the king has won the battle. And because the king has won the battle, all these other skirmishes that are taking place all over here, they can stop. But here's the thing. Those battles won't stop until what? They've heard the good news of the gospel. And so what's happening here as we think about prophecy and as we think about the gospel and as we think about seeing Jesus in our waiting, the people of God have a long history of waiting. From Genesis 3:15 all the way until Jesus comes in the incarnation as the Messiah in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, like they have a history and tradition of waiting. But God has been so gracious, so kind to them, that even in the midst of their waiting, that he has sent them pictures, signs, symbols, gospel messages, that their time is coming, that the Messiah would come, and that he would, in fact, not just bruise the head, but crush the enemy under his feet.
That's right. And I really love that even though we see it in Genesis 3:15, we don't see Jesus come in person for a long time. You just mentioned this, but they were waiting for a promise to pass. And I know by the time we get to Malachi, then, I mean, that's the last book of the Old Testament, and there's quite a gap before we get to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in the timeline. And so there's this eager anticipation from the Messiah. But God was so good to remind us that our waiting is not in vain.
That's right. That's right. And so, like, we could trace even what's taking place. We could trace the Israelites and their wilderness wandering experience. We can trace the story of the Israelites in the exile after the northern and southern kingdom fall, and they're taken over by the Babylonians and the Persians. We can talk about what you just described after Malachi, the 400 years of silence, as they're waiting and just hoping that the Messiah would come. And we can talk about the Israelites who lived in the time of what's called the Second Temple period after the First Temple was destroyed. And now this great new empire called Rome has come in, and they are honestly super frustrated.
And desperate.
And they have been waiting and waiting and waiting. And it seemed like the promise that was given to them with such great assurance is now maybe even a fairy tale. Like, would this take place? And I think, Lise, this is sometimes the way that God works. Sometimes when we get to that place where we're just like, I just don't think this is ever going to happen, right in front of us, the miraculous takes place.
And just like them, it came in such an unexpected way that many people missed.
Yes.
That baby infant Jesus was the Messiah. And I know from studying in depth, really, how harsh the Romans were with the people, I understand why they were wanting the Messiah to come and be a reigning, ruling king, to take over Rome and ease the ache of the just brutality that the Romans were putting on God's people. And yet God had such a beautiful plan in mind for a complete Messiah to be a complete Savior. He wasn't just going to be a temporary earthly king to ease the ache of that time. God was going to ease the ache of humanity for all time. And so I think it's interesting too, the way Jesus came, it was prophesied that way, and still it was missed by so many people. And so I think we have to be careful when we are praying and asking God. There's two things that I always try to remember. God loves to answer our prayers, but he will not answer them at any other time than the right time and in any other way than the right way.
Yeah, that's so good. There's a famous song by U2, a guy named Bono, and they've got the song. It's called I Still Haven't Found What I'm Looking For. And I hear that song often, and I just think, maybe it's because you're looking for the wrong thing.
Wow.
And I think that's exactly what's happening with the Israelites. And here's what I just know to be true in my life. I think you can say this to be true in your life, that those moments of waiting, they can just feel brutal. They can feel like it's worthless. It can feel like it's painful. That waiting just feels like this drug out, just endless timeline of a situation.
And almost like pointless pain and unnecessary suffering.
Yeah. But let's look at the people of Israel one more time. They wanted a earthly king and an earthly ruler, and their waiting was so frustrating, but it's because what they were longing for wasn't what was best for them eternally. They wanted an immediate fix. They wanted to deal with their present situation. Yet God is too good to even allow our short-sighted understanding of what would benefit us to overcome what is the best thing for his people. And so God is always going to act out of what is best for you and I in the long run. And it was for Jesus as the Messiah to go on a cross, a symbol of total death, and to die on a cross only to overcome death itself through death 3 days later. And here's an interesting thing. At least it took over 400 years after the death of Jesus on the cross for the cross to switch from a symbol of defeat into a symbol that we now wear on chains or as earrings
of hope and salvation. Yeah.
And guess what? 400 years is a long amount of time of waiting. I think there are some of us that have experienced or in the middle of the waiting right now. We're waiting for a spouse. We're waiting for a marriage to be what we envisioned for it to be in the very beginning, maybe when we were married. We're waiting for children. We're waiting for our job, either to get a job or to get a promotion for the job that we've always wanted. I mean, we have an endless amount of things that we are waiting for. And I just wonder what would take place if we took a marked moment right now, today, for us to take a step back and say, okay, in the middle of my waiting, what is God doing and how is he shaping me and how is he forming me? Because one of the most important things for the people of Israel was for them to practice faithfulness in the middle of their waiting.
So good. And I pray that as we go through this week and study prophecy, that we will remember it wasn't just prophecy in the Old Testament. It became a promise kept in the New Testament. And that is the encouragement in our waiting, that it's not just that God says he will be there for us or he will answer and provide for us, maybe not in the exact way we expected, but God, again, is never a do-nothing God. He's always doing something. So I pray the week of prophecy this week reminds you so deeply that God is a promise-keeping God. And as we see Jesus in the Old Testament, we can see him working in our life as well.